Sir, is this the last piece to the nuclear puzzle for the North Koreans?
I think it is. Actually, should mention that I'm at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University now. That's okay. Look, it's something that, as you mentioned, has been the holy grail. It's what they've been working towards. We've been getting signals for several years now that they were getting closer and closer. Now, you will still have different groups within the intelligence community disputing whether they actually have the ability to miniaturize the warheads and mate them to missiles, whether those warheads can survive reentry, the number and the like. The point is, if you take the long view, if we look at it over the course of a decade or more, they have relentlessly been moving to this point. They are going to get there in a sense that allows them actually to begin thinking about how they would deploy these weapons, and we have to accept that we are in a new situation.
What cooperation do you think they needed to get this done? Who else do you think around the world participated to help this come to fruition?
Well, you know, it's a great question because there are multiple different types of help that they received. On the one hand, you can't do a program like this without enormous amounts of money. So whether it was China continuing to accept coal shipments or looking the other way at undermining sanctions, that helped them get the money for this. We know that they've worked with the Iranians. We know that they've worked with the Pakistanis and others. There are multiple different ways that the North Koreans have been in a two-way street, that they have been also looking to sell their missiles when they are able to perfect them. They've been getting nuclear support from other nations. The degree to which China has been supporting this program is still open to debate. We have to accept that we've completely failed in isolating them from any sources of support, and that now we're at a point where the idea of denuclearization, as was most recently asked for in the UN sanctions that were passed on Saturday, is really just a fantasy.
Yeah. This report is coming from the Washington Post, and it contradicts the information that we had just earlier today. It would be a very big story as it stands. How credible do you think it is?
Well, at this point, all you can do is try to piece together all the different sources of information that you're getting. This is extremely technical information. Some of it is depending on whether we can read the type of activity that's coming out of their nuclear weapons laboratories. We have to look what they're doing with the missiles. The fact is that no one will ever know the truth until one day they decide to do a demonstration shot. When there is a mushroom cloud that's coming from a North Korean demonstration shot, one day we'll be able to put aside all the questions whether they've reached this. You're still going to have those who dispute that they're there or that they can actually target these missiles. All of this is a continuum, but again, I think we have to put aside the fantasy of denuclearization and start accepting that North Korea is a nuclear weapons state.
Oh, Michael Auslan of the Hoover. Sir, is this the last piece to the nuclear puzzle for the North Koreans?
I think it is. Actually, should mention that I'm at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University now. That's okay. Look, it's something that, as you mentioned, has been the holy grail. It's what they've been working towards. We've been getting signals for several years now that they were getting closer and closer. Now, you will still have different groups within the intelligence community disputing whether they actually have the ability to miniaturize the warheads and mate them to missiles, whether those warheads can survive reentry, the number and the like. The point is, if you take the long view, if we look at it over the course of a decade or more, they have relentlessly been moving to this point. They are going to get there in a sense that allows them actually to begin thinking about how they would deploy these weapons, and we have to accept that we are in a new situation.
What cooperation do you think they needed to get this done? Who else do you think around the world participated to help this come to fruition?
Well, you know, it's a great question because there are multiple different types of help that they received. On the one hand, you can't do a program like this without enormous amounts of money. So whether it was China continuing to accept coal shipments or looking the other way at undermining sanctions, that helped them get the money for this. We know that they've worked with the Iranians. We know that they've worked with the Pakistanis and others. There are multiple different ways that the North Koreans have been in a two-way street, that they have been also looking to sell their missiles when they are able to perfect them. They've been getting nuclear support from other nations. The degree to which China has been supporting this program is still open to debate. We have to accept that we've completely failed in isolating them from any sources of support, and that now we're at a point where the idea of denuclearization, as was most recently asked for in the UN sanctions that were passed on Saturday, is really just a fantasy.
Yeah. This report is coming from the Washington Post, and it contradicts the information that we had just earlier today. It would be a very big story as it stands. How credible do you think it is?
Well, at this point, all you can do is try to piece together all the different sources of information that you're getting. This is extremely technical information. Some of it is depending on whether we can read the type of activity that's coming out of their nuclear weapons laboratories. We have to look what they're doing with the missiles. The fact is that no one will ever know the truth until one day they decide to do a demonstration shot. When there is a mushroom cloud that's coming from a North Korean demonstration shot, one day we'll be able to put aside all the questions whether they've reached this. You're still going to have those who dispute that they're there or that they can actually target these missiles. All of this is a continuum, but again, I think we have to put aside the fantasy of denuclearization and start accepting that that North Korea is a nuclear weapons state.
Oh, Michael Auslan of the Hoover. Sir, is this the last piece to the nuclear puzzle for the North Koreans?
I think it is. Actually, should mention that I'm at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University now. That's okay. Look, it's something that, as you mentioned, has been the holy grail. It's what they've been working towards. We've been getting signals for several years now that they were getting closer and closer. Now, you will still have different groups within the intelligence community disputing whether they actually have the ability to miniaturize the warheads and mate them to missiles, whether those warheads can survive reentry, the number and the like. The point is, if you take the long view, if we look at it over the course of a decade or more, they have relentlessly been moving to this point. They are going to get there in a sense that allows them actually to begin thinking about how they would deploy these weapons, and we have to accept that we are in a new situation.
What cooperation do you think they needed to get this done? Who else do you think around the world participated to help this come to fruition?
Well, you know, it's a great question because there are multiple different types of help that they received. On the one hand, you can't do a program like this without enormous amounts of money. So whether it was China continuing to accept coal shipments or looking the other way at undermining sanctions, that helped them get the money for this. We know that they've worked with the Iranians. We know that they've worked with the Pakistanis and others. There are multiple different ways that the North Koreans have been in a two-way street, that they have been also looking to sell their missiles when they are able to perfect them. They've been getting nuclear support from other nations. The degree to which China has been supporting this program is still open to debate. We have to accept that we've completely failed in isolating them from any sources of support, and that now we're at a point where the idea of denuclearization, as was most recently asked for in the UN sanctions that were passed on Saturday, is really just a fantasy.
Yeah. This report is coming from the Washington Post, and it contradicts the information that we had just earlier today. It would be a very big story as it stands. How credible do you think it is?
Well, at this point, all you can do is try to piece together all the different sources of information that you're getting. This is extremely technical information. Some of it is depending on whether we can read the type of activity that's coming out of their nuclear weapons laboratories. We have to look what they're doing with the missiles. The fact is that no one will ever know the truth until one day they decide to do a demonstration shot. When there is a mushroom cloud that's coming from a North Korean demonstration shot, one day we'll be able to put aside all the questions whether they've reached this. You're still going to have those who dispute that they're there or that they can actually target these missiles. All of this is a continuum, but again, I think we have to put aside the fantasy of denuclearization and start accepting that that North Korea is a nuclear weapons state.
Oh, Michael Auslan of the Hoover. Sir, is this the last piece to the nuclear puzzle for the North Koreans?
I think it is. Actually, should mention that I'm at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University now. That's okay. Look, it's something that, as you mentioned, has been the holy grail. It's what they've been working towards. We've been getting signals for several years now that they were getting closer and closer. Now, you will still have different groups within the intelligence community disputing whether they actually have the ability to miniaturize the warheads and mate them to missiles, whether those warheads can survive reentry, the number and the like. The point is, if you take the long view, if we look at it over the course of a decade or more, they have relentlessly been moving to this point. They're going to get there in a sense that allows them actually to begin thinking about how they would deploy these weapons, and we have to accept that we are in a new situation.
What cooperation do you think they needed to get this done? Who else do you think around the world participated to help this come to fruition?
Well, you know, it's a great question because there are multiple different types of help that they received. On the one hand, you can't do a program like this without enormous amounts of money. So whether it was China continuing to accept coal shipments or looking the other way at undermining sanctions, that helped them get the money for this. We know that they've worked with the Iranians. We know that they've worked with the Pakistanis and others. There are multiple different ways that the North Koreans have been in a two-way street, that they have been also looking to sell their missiles when they are able to perfect them. They've been getting nuclear support from other nations. The degree to which China has been supporting this program is still open to debate. We have to accept that we've completely failed in isolating them from any sources of support, and that now we're at a point where the idea of denuclearization, as was most recently asked for in the UN sanctions that were passed on Saturday, is really just a fantasy.
Yeah. This report is coming from the Washington Post, and it contradicts the information that we had just earlier today. It would be a very big story as it stands. How credible do you think it is?
Well, at this point, all you can do is try to piece together all the different sources of information that you're getting. This is extremely technical information. Some of it is depending on whether we can read the type of activity that's coming out of their nuclear weapons laboratories. We have to look what they're doing with the missiles. The fact is that no one will ever know the truth until one day they decide to do a demonstration shot. When there is a mushroom cloud that's coming from a North Korean demonstration shot, one day we'll be able to put aside all the questions whether they've reached this. You're still going to have those who dispute that they're there or that they can actually target these missiles. All of this is a continuum, but again, I think we have to put aside the fantasy of denuclearization and start accepting that North Korea is a nuclear weapon state.
Oh, Michael Osland of the Hoover.